Also, take a look at your bulletin. There's a bio on the back about them. On the back also is upcoming events at the church for April. Please take note of those and where you can participate, we'd like you to do that. And please sign up for the small group discussions that are going to be ongoing next week, and I guess the next 3 or 4 weeks. These on the pulpit right outside the door there, we appreciate if you participate and sign in for that. Any other announcements? Anybody have anything else they want to bring up? If not, let us prepare our minds and march to receive the Lord. Please join me in the call of worship, the first John 1 through 4. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life.
This is why it was revealed, and we have seen it.
We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ.
We are writing these things so that joy may be complete.
Our hymn is number 224, Rejoice, the Lord is King, number 23.
Join me in the prayer of confession. It's put in the bulletin. It's taken from 1 John 1, 6-8. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not know what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship
Thank you.
hear these beautiful words of assurance? If we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Stand as we say, glory, sing, glory, back.
Talks
about Jesus being present at creation gives a whole different perspective from the earthly individual that the other Gospels talk about. I decided to focus on doubt, though, this week, this class, this sermon here, because this is where we get the expression doubting Thomas. And it's important for us to recognize as we go through here how important doubt is for us. I go so far to ask, is it a good thing or a bad thing? What about doubt in your faith? Do you have doubt in aspects about your faith? Are there parts of your faith that are just so difficult, so incomprehensible, so out of this world that you kind of struggle with them? You're not quite sure how to take them or how to articulate them to others. This passage that I wrote to you is full of doubt. It's not just Thomas. You should know that verse 18, right before I started, has Mary Magdalene bursting into the disciples, and she says, "I've seen the Lord." But the fact that the boys, and probably a lot of women, are in a room with the doors locked in fear implies that they're not excited with this announcement by Mary. We can read in the other Gospels, it says flatly that they chose not to believe her because it sounded like nonsense. You might not realize it, but I found it quite amazing to realize that Jesus articulated his death and resurrection a number of times to his disciples. And he did it very specifically. He didn't talk in parables or analogies. He spelled it right out. He did it at least three times, and it's recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. I'm going to read you what he said in Mark. Mark 10, verses 33 to 34, he says this to the disciples. "See, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. And they will mock him and spit on him and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days he will arise." He said that pretty specifically. We're going to hear later about how they struggled with that statement. But we need to realize that the disciples who were hiding behind this locked door are filled with doubt. Yes, Thomas isn't with them. Perhaps his doubt is so great that he's not even hanging out with them anymore. But then Jesus appears to them. And there's a little miracle in there in case you don't realize, because he kind of appears in the room past the locked door. And he says, "Peace be with you," and he fills them with the Holy Spirit, which we could get into in a whole other theological discussion. But they believe him. They're thrilled. I just can't wrap my head around how they must feel in that situation. So then Thomas shows up. And of course, they're so excited. They say, "We've seen the Lord, we've seen the Lord." And poor Thomas, we don't know what frame of mind he is in, but he must really be struggling. And when I read that passage where he says, "Unless I see the holes and put my finger in the holes and put my hand in the side," that's just pure angry sarcasm on his part. He's telling them they've lost their mind. There's no way. Science doesn't support that. History doesn't support that. My spirit can't support that. He waits a whole week. Scripture says that a whole week goes by. Do the other disciples continue to try to explain to him? Are they living a life, these disciples that have seen Jesus now, are they living a life that shows this joy and optimism, or does Thomas's doubts kind of pull them down, and do they begin to think, was it really what made me one of them? And then Jesus does it again. Again, they're in a locked room. So it makes me wonder just how excited and believing all the disciples are. But then all of a sudden, Jesus is there. But this time, Thomas is present. And Jesus walks up to him. Can you imagine this? And he says, "Hi, Thomas. Here's my hands. Here's my side." How do you think Thomas must have felt? I can't imagine. He must have felt embarrassed. He must have felt joyful. He must have looked at the other disciples who were standing there looking at him. And he says, "My Lord and my God." This account here in John is I just love this because I can see myself in here. Those times, I mean, even though I'm in seminary right now, things get discussed and presented, and you know, there's a piece of me that just goes, I love the last verse, verse 31. "These things are written so that you come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name." They're sharing these tremendous doubts by actual disciples that lived and walked and breathed and ate with Jesus despite. And they're sharing these so that you know how hard it was for them to believe as well. So I always like to, you know, get into the Greek, and you might be interested to know that within Scripture, there's actually four Greek terms that are translated into English, doubt. And it should set off alarm bells for you, because if there are distinctive Greek words for some type of emotion, then when we clump it all together with one word, doubt, we lose some of that understanding. We lose some of that meaning. I can't pronounce the Greek words, so I'm not even going to share them with you. But one of them means to waver. And that's when Peter stepped out of the boat. He had enough faith to believe that he could walk on water just like Jesus. But as he walks, he begins to waver. What am I doing? And Jesus says to him, "Why did you doubt? Why did you waver?" But there's a lot of faith there when you think about it. Another word means to deliberate to oneself or to ask questions. And we do that all the time. How come? Why? Can I figure this out? And that's a wise thing to do. We should ask questions. We should seek affirmation from Scripture and from those we trust. There's nothing wrong with that doubt either. Then there's a kind of doubt that makes a distinction, that tries to separate the good from the bad. And again, there's nothing wrong with that. Throughout our entire lives, we go from one place to another and we hear things. Hear all kinds of stuff on the news these days, and of course everything on the internet is true, you know, right? So that we begin to distinguish different things, and we begin to think, well, wait, I have to find a little bit more supportive proof before I buy into that. And that doubt's good too. None of those doubts are the Greek word that gets translated to doubt with Thomas. Thomas, standing there with his disciples, with his hands on his hips, pointing and saying all of his sarcastic, angry, desperate things, his doubt meant feeling of uncertainty, lack of conviction, fearful, afraid, unbelieving, incredulous, lack of trust. This is what Jesus says to him, "Thomas, why did you doubt?" This is a far believing, disbelieving. This is a point where you're far away and you've reached a point where you're not wavering. You're not discerning. You're not trying to distinguish. You've even stopped asking questions. You're way over here on the doubt meter. I think that this is when they begin to discuss, and the Bible talks about hard-hearted, where you reach a point where nothing's going to change your mind. Now, I'll point out the whole thing about resurrection. That's a pretty tough one. So let's talk about Thomas. He only shows up in the Gospel of John, and it kind of makes sense when you examine Thomas, because it goes along with John's whole agenda that Jesus is more than just this wonderful individual and teacher. Jesus is this divine being that's come to earth. Because Thomas says four things you should know in the Gospel of John. And they're very telling, and it's tremendously unfortunate that we only remember his doubting, and that phrase, doubting Thomas. I want you to imagine if your worst, most embarrassing example as a human being or a faith person was remembered to such an extent that thousands of years from now it's an expression of not necessarily positive things. Don't be a doubting Thomas. That's what poor Thomas, that's what his legacy is, and I'm hoping maybe change your mind. The first time you see Thomas and he speaks is in John 11, and Jesus has just told his disciples they're going to go to Jerusalem. They're going to go to Jerusalem, and the disciples are not keen on this, because it's reached a point in Jesus' ministry that the scribes and the high priests are really annoyed with him, to the point where they're plotting his death. And so the whole idea of going to Jerusalem, the holy city where the most power of this religion resides, is kind of crazy. And Thomas, you might be surprised to say, says, let's all go, and if we die with him, we die. Previously, Peter had said, poor Peter, he's a follower. So Thomas, he's ready to go and die. This gives me a glimpse of an eager puppy, someone who has no clue about what he's really talking about. It's those times when somebody says, hey, would you like to help me with the flower sale? It's next Saturday, and you say, flowers, okay, and then you get there and there's $600 worth of flowers that have just been dumped out of the truck, and you've got to sort them and get ready to sell, and you think, what have I done? So Thomas is eager, he's ready to go and die, and he must have been quite an inspiration to the disciples at that time. Well, Thomas wants to go, okay, let's go. The next glimpse we get is right after Jesus has talked again about his death. And they're all having an intimate supper, the disciples with Jesus. And Jesus says to them, I'm leaving. I'm going to go, but you can't come with me. Now they've gone with him everywhere. He goes, but you can't go with me. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And don't worry, there's plenty of room. But I'll come back, but you can't come with me. And don't worry, you know the way. And Thomas, sitting there blinking, and he does a very wise thing. He says, how do we know where the way is when we don't even know where you're going? It's a brave thing for him to do, because there are many instances where the disciples ask Jesus a question, and he says, ay, 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 do I have to explain this to you again? To the point where there are lots of times in the gospel accounts where they wonder, but they're afraid to ask. So we got a little bit of more, we got bravery here, and this is Thomas eagerly trying to understand all this. Okay, we're here in Jerusalem, and you know, things are not good, and now you're gonna leave us? So it's beautiful. It's beautiful that he's eager. He's not just saying, hey, let's pack up and get out of here. And then the crucifixion happens. The worst possible thing beyond imagination occurs. They arrest him. They do spit on him. emails you know about the art, right? And so Tom is, his whole mind is blown. He's reached a point where he's following an individual, he's ready to die for him, and the individual gets killed. And so, when he shows up in that room, and the disciples are all excited, we saw him. That sarcastic comment about the finger and the holes and the hand and the side comes out. He's way past anything. And then our Lord shows up that week later. And he says to Thomas, "Here I am. Do what you need to do." And Thomas says, "My Lord and my God." And it's such a short little phrase that we tend to kind of gloss over it a little bit. But the reality is that this is the strongest statement of faith a human being can make. You're acknowledging Lord, which means they have complete control over you, like a master. You are also saying that I believe you are God. This is the first time in the Gospel of John that an individual will call Jesus God. Prior to that, he's the Son of God or the Son of Man. This is the first time that a human being says, "My Lord and my God." Do you say that? Can you say that? Makes you begin to think that sometimes you maybe have to have the worst possible experience to appreciate the best possible experience. So Thomas was in pretty good company. You should know in Scripture. Doubt is throughout Scripture. Sarah and Abraham laughed when God told them that they were going to have enough descendants to be uncountable, like the sand on the shore or the stars in the skies. And considering they didn't have a baby until she was 90 and he was 100, they were allowed to chuckle. Moses doubted that he could bring the people out of Egypt and tried to come up with all kinds of excuses. Zechariah, the priest, when the angel visits him and tells him that Elizabeth's going to have a baby, he's so incredulous that the angel punishes him and he can't speak for her whole pregnancy. Paul doubted the Messiah, that Jesus was the Messiah, so tremendously, good Jewish boy that he was, that he set out to kill all the people who claimed that Jesus was the Messiah. So this pattern of doubt, I started to get very philosophical about it all. I started to think, is faith the opposite of doubt? Or is doubt the fertilizer of faith? Do we actually need doubt to have faith? Does doubt help us grow and learn? Doubt does not have to necessarily be a bad thing. So, I've mentioned that wonderful word, faith, and you should know we throw it around a lot, but faith actually must have doubt, because faith can't be proven. Faith is a personal decision that we make. It's that discerning, that distinguishing, that questioning, that wavering, and then that final decision to step over the line, despite no physical concrete proof, and to say, "My Lord and my God." I have all kinds of quotes I've collected over the course of my life about faith, and I'd like to read some of them to you. The first one, of course, comes from Scripture, Hebrews 11:1. Faith is the confidence what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. Oswald Chambers, he says, faith is not intelligent understanding. Faith is a deliberate commitment to see a person where there is seems to be no way. Philip Yancey says, faith is believing in advance what only makes sense in reverse. I like that one. Tozer says, faith is the gaze of a soul upon a saving God. And C.S. Lewis says, faith is the art of holding on to things in spite of your changing moods or circumstances. So, here we are. They've left us this beautiful story in John with Thomas and the rest of the Bible crew who consistently doubt. And yet there are so many examples. And our scripture consistently says, we're telling you this story so you know you're not alone. With your doubts and with your questions and with your wavering, it's okay. We all did it. At the transfiguration, this is after Jesus rises from the dead. After he finally convinces all the disciples that he really is here and alive. And then he takes them to a mountaintop and somehow ascends into heaven. The last part of that description of that story, it says, but some of them doubted. I mean, hello, what more could you want to see? Our reality is that today, right now, here sitting in this church, we have the blessing of the Holy Spirit within us, who gives us clarity and strength and inspiration and questions. Questions? Go ahead, ask that question. We also have a tremendous amount of knowledge. We stand on the shoulders of giants who've gone before us and doubted and argued and questioned and come up with all different kinds of theories about these divine things that our human brains really can't understand. And we have scripture. We have scripture that people in the first century did not have. It's good that we waver. It's good that we discern. It's good that we deliberate. But we must decide. And no decision is a decision. Did you know that in that interchange with Thomas, Jesus spoke specifically about you, about us, here, in the 21st century. He says to Thomas, I'm so glad you've believed because you've seen me. But blessed are those who have not seen me and yet still have come to believe. That's us. That's recognizing that it's going to be tough for us. That's why we have the Holy Spirit with us to help us. And so I pray that you have that good kind of doubt that makes you ask and question and grow and learn and pursue and strive. I pray that the Holy Spirit continues to encourage you and give you enlightenment. And I pray that you reach a point that you can confidently say, my Lord and my God. Will you pray with me? My Lord and my God, we come before you this Sunday, and we have lots of questions. We are looking for answers. That's why we're here. We're trying to discern what you need for us and what you need us to do. I thank you for these individuals that are here today, that have gotten out of bed on this beautiful Sunday morning and are turned on the internet to read and listen to us. And I pray that each one of them will be filled with your spirit, that spirit of excitement that Thomas felt when he exclaimed, my Lord and my God. We ask all these things in Jesus' name, amen. Now, we have to figure out what we're doing. We have to make it
here. We will be singing the hymn 205, verses 1-3. Hallelujah, Jesus is risen. Hallelujah.
Thank you very much for that assistance.
Thank you.
for this opportunity for us to give back so that we can continue to be your hands and feet wherever you need us to be, whether we give with time or effort or monies, Lord. Let them all be things and actions that you need us to do. In Jesus' name.
We believe that this is God's table, and all who love and seek to follow Jesus are welcome here. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, the meal which we are about to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, communion, and hope. Come to have communion with the same Christ who has promised to be with us even to the end of the world.
We come in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are our pledge for the taste of the new heaven and the new earth where we shall show the love of God.
Come to this feast of our Lord, not because you ought, but because you may. Not because you are righteous, but because you are penitent. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak, not because you are whole, because you are broken. Come, eat this bread, drink this wine, and receive the healing grace of Christ, the empowering love of God, and the fellowship in the Spirit.
Jesus said, I was hungry, and you gave me food.
I was thirsty.
Here is the bread of life given for us. Here is the fruit of the vine poured out for us. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy and right it is to always give you thanks and praise in all places, O God, our Creator. Source of all life and goodness, you created heaven with all its hosts, and the earth with all its plenty, and preserve us by your providence. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Grant that, being joined together in Christ, we may attain to the unity of the faith and grow up in all things into Christ our Lord. Since the Lord has now fed us at this table,
let us praise God's holy name with our hearts.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And all that is within me, bless thy soul in me.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And do not forget all God's kindness.
Who forgives all your iniquity.
Who heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit.
Who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
The Lord is merciful and gracious.
Slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
God does not deal with us according to our sins.
Nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth,
so great is the Lord's steadfast love for those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west,
so far is our God from our transgressions from us.
As a parent has compassion for their children,
so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him.
Who did not spare the Son, but gave him up for us all, and will also give us all things with him.
Therefore shall our mouth and our heart show forth
the praise of the Lord
from this time forward and forevermore. Amen.
You were the disciples at Jesus' table, just like Thomas and the rest.
What prayers do we have? Prayers and praises do we have? Anything in particular? Yes.
Prayers for my friend's mom. She's 93 years old. Her name is Maureen, and she's in the hospital as of Friday night. They're not quite sure, so I would ask for clarity for the doctors who are treating her so that they can come up with a diagnosis.
Okay. Prayers for Maureen, 93 years old, who's been brought to the hospital, but they're not exactly sure why, so they're doing tests. And we're praying for clarity and peace for the family, I'm sure. Other things? Yes, June.
Thanksgiving for the beautiful music today.
Yes, prayers for Thanksgiving for the beautiful music. I told them earlier that Poshbell's canon was part of our wedding. We might have almost renewed our vows here this morning.
Everyone.
Yes, sir. Yes, it was announced on the news this morning that Israel is pulling out of its troops out of southern Gaza. So we're prayerful that that will indeed be followed through. Mary, did you have something?
They said thanks for you for coming today.
Oh, my pleasure. It's always a pleasure to come here. All right. Oh, yes.
Just prayers for whatever's happening right now outside our doors.
Yes, the sirens have been going on. For our community, yes. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come before you ever thankful, but as usual with many requests, Lord, we put before you all these things at your feet. You know the details and the specifics of the things that we prayed aloud about and also the things that we keep quietly in your heart. You know the answers to things that we can't answer, and the reasons for things we can't just figure a reason about. You know our doubts and our worries, and we bring them all to you, Lord, the best place for them to be, and we give them to you, and we ask you, Lord, for clarity, for understanding, for strength, for peace. We ask you to surround those that we love and care about with friends and family and doctors that are wise and caring and have the right words and know the right information. We pray for all of those in parts of the world that we can't even comprehend, Lord, that continue to struggle with issues and situations that also are beyond our understanding. We pray for Peace, Lord, we pray for peace in the hearts of individuals besides just these nations that need that. We pray for our community, Lord, for safety, for health. We think about the earthquake this past week, and the solar eclipse this coming week, and the flooding that we've had, Lord, and this earth is struggling just like we are. And we thank you for your creation, and we thank you for your assured love, blessing, and care. We join together in the prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us, saying,